If everyone could please take their seats so we can get started with the next speaker, that would be awesome. It is my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Mr. Alex Epstein. Alex Epstein is a philosopher and energy expert who argues that human flourishing should be the guiding principle of industrial and environmental progress. He's the author of the New York Times bestseller, The Moral Case for Fossil Fuels. Mr. Epstein has made his morality-based case for fossil fuels at dozens of campuses, including Harvard, Yale, Stanford, and his alma mater, Duke. He has also spoken to employees and leaders at dozens of Fortune 500 energy companies. Mr. Epstein is known for his willingness to debate anyone, anytime, and has publicly debated leading environmental organizations such as Greenpeace, the Sierra Club, and 350.org over the morality of fossil fuel use. In fact, you can now invite Mr. Epstein to speak on your campus this academic year through Young America's Foundation, which is proud to be sponsoring him for a series of lectures across the country. Visit YAF.org or contact one of our staff members to get started with this process. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Alex Epstein.
All right. Thank you. All right. Hey, everyone. So today I'm going to be sharing with you an idea that maybe even if you're pro-freedom, you might not expect to agree with, and that I certainly didn't expect to agree with when I was your age. And so this is the idea that one of the best things you can do to make the world a better place is to fight for the freedom to use more fossil fuels. So one of the best things you can do is fight for the freedom to use more fossil fuels. And I'm really going to encourage you, I know you're advocates, and so I'm going to really encourage at least some of you to become advocates on this issue. And I believe in practicing what I preach, so I thought I would show first just a quick video of me actually doing this. This is at the biggest anti-fossil fuel rally in history. There were 300,000 people marching down Sixth Avenue in New York City against fossil fuels, and so I flew over from California to pay a visit. I don't know, can we play this? I don't have the play capability right now. Do you hear what they're saying? Hey, hey, ho, ho, fossil fuels have got to go. I have a very different opinion on the matter. Let's go see if we can engage. Can we just go stand in the middle? So anyway, that was a very entertaining day. Thanks. All right, so a lot happened that day. Some people tried to grab my sign unsuccessfully, and so, which is actually a reminder. You have cards at your desk, and the main reason I want to give you these cards is so that I can share with you resources that cover what I'm covering today, as well as hundreds of other points that will be useful to you, and especially they'll be useful to share with others. So one of the things, maybe not the most important, but you can see the 12 videos of me interacting with protesters at the People's Climate March. And if anyone is watching this online, all you need to do is just go to alexepsteinlist.com, and you can sign up and get the same thing. Okay, so yeah, so I've become this major advocate for fossil fuels. As I said, this is not at all what I expected. So I wanted to share with you today basically how I came to think about this issue with the hopes that you'll think about it in a similar way and then share it with other people. So I grew up in a place called Chevy Chase, Maryland, which is in the DC area, which you may or may not know is not a super pro fossil fuel area. And I grew up, you know, in kind of a liberal environment, and I went to Duke, and I never heard anything pro-fossil fuel my entire upbringing. And this image really captures my energy so-called education, the solar car. So when I was growing up and, you know, going to school in the 80s and 90s, I was told, oh, this is the future, the solar car. And so now I suddenly went from that to this huge advocate of fossil fuels. And so how is that? And I think the key is that I decided when I was 20 to join the profession that most people think is the most worthless profession in the world. I was in computer science at the time, and I told my advisor, I'm leaving computer science because I want to become a philosopher. And he was very unimpressed. I'm glad some of you think that's a good idea. But he was not impressed. And people generally think it's very unimpressive. And I'll show you a clip. This was me testifying in front of the Senate Environment and Public Works Committee. I live in California. My senator at the time was Barbara Boxer. And she was very unimpressed with having a philosopher there. And then I explained to her why it was actually very valuable.
Mr. Epstein.
Okay, one more time. I'll play it. You play it. Okay.
Mr. Epstein, are you a scientist?
No, philosopher.
You're a philosopher?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this is the Environment and Public Works Committee. I think it's interesting we have a philosopher here talking about an issue.
It's to teach you how to think more clearly.
Well, you don't have to teach me how to think more clearly. You don't have to try.
Yeah, so that was... Thanks. So actually, I didn't plan that line, but that's just what came to mind, because I think of philosophy as it helps you think more clearly. I actually think of it as the most practical thing, if it's done right, which I don't think it usually is. And I'm going to argue today that actually 90% of disagreement about energy, including climate, is about philosophy, not about facts. So that's an unusual claim, because most people think it's just about facts, but I think it's actually mostly about philosophy, and I think bad philosophy causes people to think about the facts in a way that actually makes no sense if you actually think about it. So I want to share with you the basic philosophical ideas that made me think about this issue differently, and then I think you'll see the facts are pretty straightforward. So one of the key ideas that I got from philosophy is that whenever you're thinking about your choices, you always need to look at what I call the full context. So that means you carefully weigh the benefits and side effects of every option. So for example, you're considering taking an antibiotic or a vaccine. You need to, anyone, whatever your opinion of a given antibiotic or vaccine should agree, you have to carefully look at the benefits and you have to carefully look at the side effects. If you ignore the benefits of something and just look at the side effects, you're gonna make a bad decision. And if you just look at the side effects and ignore the benefits, you're gonna make a bad decision. Yet what I notice with fossil fuels is we almost always just look at the negative side effects. So we talk about negative impacts on climate, pollution, but almost never talk about the benefits. And if you notice with green energy, it's the opposite. It's, we only talk about the benefits of solar and wind and rarely talk about the side effects. So that doesn't mean that one or the other is better, but it means that there's a bias and you can't think about it rationally if you have that bias. So I was very interested in, if we look at the full context, what's the truth? And the other aspect, and this is a little more subtle, but I think this is actually the most important thing, is when we're talking about our options and we're talking about like what's really gonna make the world better. Well, there's a question of what is our goal? How do we define a better world? And I think this is really the key of what's going differently. So I define a better world by the goal of what I call advancing human flourishing. So that means that I want to see more human beings live long, healthy, opportunity-filled lives, which of course requires freedom. So when I'm looking at the world, I'm looking at it in terms of, is human flourishing advancing? What can we do there? And most people might think, yeah, that's good, I agree with that, but I actually don't think most people are thinking about it that way. They're accidentally thinking about it a different way. The way most people think about this, the way we're taught to think about it, is actually our goal should be to eliminate our impact on the Earth. That is actually the goal that is driving people most of the time, eliminating our impact on the Earth. So I'll give an example. I'm gonna talk about how important energy is. And one fact about energy is that there are 3 billion people who use almost no energy. And to me, that guarantees poverty, that guarantees a lack of opportunity. And yet, how often do most publications cover that, like the New York Times, the Washington Post, even more conservative publications often, they almost never talk about 3 billion people without energy. But what do people care about so much? They care if there's a story about one polar bear has to move from one piece of ice to another, everyone is crying and upset. And polar bear is my favorite animal, by the way, but there's still a big problem with nobody cares about 3 billion people not having energy, and everyone is obsessed with, what happens to this or that polar bear, which, by the way, polar bear populations have grown considerably to the point where they're a threat to many of the local people in the Arctic. Another example, this came out today. There was a study by The Lancet, a medical publication, and it said it was studying how with more warming, like a warmer world, you have a lot fewer cold-related deaths. And it actually said that more lives are saved from having fewer cold-related deaths than are taken through more heat-related deaths. And if you think of this, it's actually common sense because there are way more cold-related deaths in the world than heat-related deaths. And yet, why does nobody ever talk about this? People only talk about our impact on climate as it has to be bad. I'm not saying it's all good or even it's mostly good, But it stands to reason it's going to be some good, some bad if we're changing things, and yet people only talk about the negatives. So there, they're not looking at it from a human flourishing perspective. They're looking at it from the perspective of it's bad for us to impact the Earth. One more example is when we put more CO2 in the atmosphere, everybody acknowledges that makes the planet greener. And it actually significantly helps food production, and it helps wildlife grow everywhere. And yet almost nobody talks about that as good. Why? Because we think it's bad for us to impact the world. And so I challenge that idea morally. I think it's good for us to impact the world if it advances human flourishing. And if you don't believe that, then you can't have a society at all, because everything we do to advance our lives impacts the world in one way or another. So I'm stressing this, you know, in my limited time, because I think this issue of, is your goal to advance human flourishing or is it to eliminate human impact? I think that is really the core issue. And if you think about the world in terms of advancing human flourishing, you have to conclude that fossil fuels are really amazing. Okay, so with that in mind, I'm gonna give you sort of a quick rundown of, I think, the key facts that show that fossil fuels going forward are so valuable that we need to use actually far more of them. And we definitely need the freedom to use more. So I'm gonna go through these facts, hopefully not too quickly, but pretty quickly. Again, I'm gonna send you some resources at the end, but I want you to get the overall constellation of facts and then have plenty of time for questions. And by the way, everything I'm gonna share here, this is not some special conservative fact or some obscure thing. All the data I'm using are from nonpartisan sources. So the difference is it's all about the philosophy. It's when you look at the facts from a pro-human philosophy and you look at the full context, it's actually pretty obvious that we need more fossil fuels, not less. Okay. And by the way, human flourishing, when I talk about that, that includes a safe and healthy environment. So it's not human flourishing versus an environment, a good environment. A good environment is a crucial part of it. Okay. So this is going to be my high-level case. So point one, is that for decades to come, fossil fuels will be by far the lowest cost source of reliable energy for billions of people. That's point one. Point two is that low cost reliable energy is fundamental to human flourishing, including a safe and healthy environment. And then point three is that continuing use of low cost reliable fossil fuel energy will cause some warming, but it will be slow and masterable, not catastrophic. So I'm not at all saying we don't impact climate. I think we definitely do impact climate. There's a difference between believing we do impact climate and that it's a catastrophe. And I'm going to show I do not think there's any evidence at all that there's a catastrophe. And in fact, we're getting safer from climate overall. Okay, so let's jump in. Why do I say that fossil fuels will be by far the lowest cost source of reliable energy for billions of people? Because this contradicts what we hear. We hear that solar and wind, so-called renewables, I think they should be called unreliables, by the way, because I think it's a more accurate description. Because, by the way, renewables usually excludes hydro, which we'll talk about in a minute, why the green movement is so anti-hydro and anti-nuclear. But we're here, solar and wind are rapidly replacing fossil fuels. Well, is that true? So this is energy use around the world. And you can see the fossil fuels, oil, coal, natural gas, are incredibly dominant still. So they produce 80% of the world's energy. You know, solar and wind are around 3%. Okay, so that is a fact we should take seriously. They're also growing very fast, including in the developing world, you know, particularly in China and India. So a second fact that's important is that there has been over 100 years of very strong competition with fossil fuels. So it's not that fossil fuels have been around forever and everything else is new. All these alternatives you hear about have been around for 100 plus years. The only exception is nuclear, but even that's been around for about 75 years. So we have fossil fuels are so dominant everywhere in the world, and yet they've had so much competition. And then the other thing we should know is that historically, so this is one of the leading energy guys in the world. I don't think he deserves to be, but his name is Amory Lovins. And look at this quote from him in 1976, where he discusses how solar can rapidly replace fossil fuels, and he's talking about it back then. This is the kind of thing we hear. So we really need to take seriously. Fossil fuels are so successful, there must be something special about them. It can't just be a conspiracy. It's not that they're going out rapidly. And so why is this? Because you might think, well, shouldn't solar and wind be cheaper because they're free? And this is what we hear all the time. Oh, they're free and they're forever. But that fails to understand a key point. And this is one of the takeaway points I want to give to you, which is that energy is a process. So whenever you think about the cost of energy, you need to think of what is the whole cost of making energy reliable. So you have to look at the mining, the manufacturing, everything, the land costs. And then the key thing we're going to focus on with solar and wind is that they have a particular set of costs that have to do with reliability. So this is Germany, which is considered a model of green energy, and they use a lot of solar and wind. So solar is the black, wind is the gray, and then you can see them combining. And you see sometimes you get as much you get about half, let's say, of Germany's electricity needs at a given time. And then the media says, oh, Germany is getting half of its electricity from solar and wind. But what they don't say is that other times it's getting about 0%. And so here's an easy math question. When you have a source of electricity that can go to zero at any time, what percentage backup do you need? You need 100, right? So what you have to recognize is that is a cost. The cost of solar and wind is not just the cost of the solar panels or even the transmission lines, it's also the cost of the backup. And what we can see sometimes, though, is sometimes people try to get, they try to play what I call reliability chicken. So they want to have the solar and wind and they want to cut down on the backup. That's what we've done in California where I live, and that's also what's happened in Texas. Texas's reliable electricity has not kept pace. So there's this narrative that, oh, the windmills didn't fail or they froze. And this is actually most of what happened in Texas is most of that stuff at the beginning is before there was a failure before the wind turbines froze. So what happened in Texas, the main thing is part of it was the wind turbines froze, but the main things were one, wind doesn't blow when it's really cold and when it's really hot. And that's when you need electricity the most. So that's one of the points. But the other point that's even more important is that all the money that went to wind and solar, that took money away from reliable power plants and particularly toward what's called resiliency, toward making them weather resistant. So people say, oh, you weren't weatherized. Well, if you spend $70 billion on wind and solar, then you don't have the money to weatherize your other plants. So it's really that the solar and wind, they defund the reliable power. So it's actually that these solar and wind schemes are, they're always government mandated and they're always a debacle. And that's why they're always adding cost to electricity. So this is the key idea. They don't replace the cost of reliable power plants, they add to the cost of reliable power plants. And so whenever you hear people claiming they're cheap, they're not looking at the full context, they're not looking at the full cost, they're just looking at, say, the cost of the panels, but not the transmission infrastructure, and particularly not the backup. So I mentioned that fossil fuels are special. What is it that makes fossil fuels so dominant? And I think a very quick explanation is they have three attributes that no other form of energy, except one, which is nuclear, which I'll talk about in a minute, has. They're naturally stored, they're naturally concentrated, naturally abundant. So solar and wind, they're what's called intermittent. They just come and go, and they're flows of energy. They're not stored. Whereas fossil fuels, they're actually stored ancient solar energy, like from hundreds of millions of years ago. And what that means is they're like a natural battery. So they're just available on demand, and you can just release the energy. And that makes things a lot cheaper. They're also very concentrated, particularly oil. Oil can store a huge amount of energy in a small space. And then they're naturally abundant. There's more than 10 times as much as all of these as we've used in the whole history of civilization. So there's no issue of running out anytime soon. Now, you might ask about nuclear and hydro. And those are great, but there are two things to note about them. One is the biggest opponents of nuclear and hydro, the ones holding them back, that's the modern green movement that claims to care about CO2. So most of the major activists who are saying, I think global warming is an existential crisis or whatever, they also oppose hydro, particularly large-scale hydro, and they oppose nuclear. So hydro is great, but it's limited in where you can build it. So you can't build it like just in the middle of a plain with no water. But it's being restricted around the world, particularly in the poor world, by the green movement. So that is a really bad thing, and we should have more of it. And then nuclear, that's the most promising because you can build it anywhere. But unfortunately, it's been virtually criminalized by the green movement for the past several generations. So it's just so far away from replacing fossil fuels. I think it could, but you're talking like three generations if we free it up. So I do believe that politicians should really be focusing on liberating nuclear. But for the foreseeable future, nothing is remotely close to fossil fuels. And as I'll talk about in a minute, it's particularly true because there are billions of people who lack energy. So the energy we need is not just what we have now, we need far more energy. Okay, so that's the truth about fossil fuels. So the overall idea is fossil fuels are by far the lowest cost source of reliable energy for decades to come. And the claims that they're not, those are usually just distortions of reality. So the second point is, how important is that? Because you might think, okay, fossil fuels, yes, they are the lowest cost source of reliable energy, but how much does that matter? Does that matter as much as climate change? You know, AOC had this quote where she said, you know, we're talking about climate scientists are telling us the world is going to end in 12 years, and you're talking about the cost. And it's like, who cares about the cost of energy? We should just care about climate change. And what I'm going to make the point is actually the cost of energy is far more important than climate change. The cost of energy is actually what keeps us safe from the climate, and it's what makes the world a good place to live. So that's something you'll almost never hear, but I think it's very provable if you look at the data. So this, to me, is the most important chart in the history of energy that almost nobody talks about. We're told that rising CO2 levels are such a problem that the world is going to end, the world is going to become an unlivable place. And yet people don't acknowledge, actually, that as we've been emitting more CO2, the world is a much more livable place. So look at these metrics. Life expectancy, it was flat, and then it jumps up like a hockey stick. And then GDP, that's how many resources the average person has. It's flat, and it goes up. And then population, the number of people the Earth can support, it's flat and it goes up. So we have the most livable world ever today. So many people can live longer lives, they have more opportunity, the Earth can support more of us, and at the same time, CO2 emissions are going up. So to me, A, the media should be constantly talking about how good life is, and notice they act like life is worse, and I think that's because the goal is not to advance human flourishing, it's to eliminate human impact. So a lot of people think, oh, it's actually bad that there are so many of us because we're having such an impact. But if you like humans, actually the world is a much better place. And so that should be discussed, and people should be really interested in it. Why is the world so much better as we use more and more fossil fuels and emit more and more CO2? And I think there are two basic reasons. So one is, and the way to think about it is, first ask, why was life bad for so long? And if you get why life was bad for so long, then you can understand why fossil fuels have made life so good. So there are two basic things. One is the nature of the Earth, and two is the nature of the human body. So the nature of the Earth, one of the reasons that people think that climate change is the biggest threat in the world, and they don't care much about energy, is what I call the delicate nurture assumption. This is a philosophical view. It's a false philosophical view, but it's very widespread. And this is the idea that the unimpacted planet, so if we don't impact the planet, it's in this perfect, delicate balance. So it's sufficient, it gives us what we need, it's safe, it's not going to endanger us too much, and it's stable. You know, when people talk about the climate, they talk about, oh yeah, we've made the climate so bad. So you see a drought and you think, oh, we've angered the climate, as if the climate was this delicate nurturer before. And the view of human beings, it's a very low view of human beings. It says we are basically parasite polluters. So all we do is we take stuff from the Earth and then we make the Earth ugly. And so the belief is human impact is bad. If we impact the Earth, it's inevitably going to hurt us. Even if it's made it better so far, it's going to make it worse in the future. So this is a dogma. It is completely untrue. The truth about the Earth is what I call wild potential. So the planet has the potential to be a good place for human beings to live. But in its wild state, when we don't impact it, it's actually deficient. It gives us very few resources. That's why life expectancy is so low. It's dangerous. It is, you know, constantly endangering us, including with climate, but also with diseases. And it's dynamic, it's ever changing. So when people talk about the climate, you have to recognize the climate is deficient. It doesn't give us enough rainfall often when we need it. It's dangerous, it's dynamic. And if you recognize this, you recognize human beings, we actually make the Earth a lot better in many ways. So we're producers. We don't just take stuff, we produce value. Like aluminum used to be useless, we made it valuable. Oil used to be useless, we made it valuable. Natural gas was useless, we made it valuable. We're producers. We also improve the planet. We make it cleaner in different ways. Like we have all this clean water, not because it naturally exists and is available, but because we clean naturally dirty water and we move it around to make it available. So if you get that, then you have a totally different perspective on human impact. You think actually human impact is a really good thing. It needs to be productive, it needs to be intelligent, but it's actually good for us to impact the Earth. And so again, I want to stress this, it's all about philosophy. If you have this false dogma that the Earth is a delicate nurturer, you're going to think of the world in one way. If you recognize that it's wild potential, you think of the world in another way. So that's the first problem is we don't live on a delicate nurturer. We just live on wild potential, and it's got all of these dangers to it. And it doesn't give us enough, so we have to be productive. But the next problem is that human beings are actually very weak. So our physical bodies are weak, so we can't actually produce very much stuff on our own. And that's why life was so bad for so long, because the Earth is not a very giving place, and we are so weak, we can't change it enough to make it into a nice place. So what is the solution? The solution is you go from manual labor, human beings using our own bodies to do things, to machine labor. So we have machines do work for us. And that is the reason the world is such an amazing place, is because we have machines producing so much value for us. So you think about energy. Energy is machine food or machine calories. That's why it's so important. So the more energy we use, the more we can use machines to produce the values we need to flourish. So take food. Nature doesn't produce very much food. It certainly doesn't produce anywhere near enough food for 8 billion people. So how do we do it? We get machines to produce food for us. So a modern combine harvester, that can allow one individual to do 700 times more work than the best manual labor. So one person using a combine harvester can reap and thresh enough wheat to replicate 700 of the best manual laborers. Think about how empowering that is. And that's what we do in every aspect of life. We figure out how to use machines to improve our lives. So a key aspect of this is the lower cost energy is, the lower cost everything is. The higher cost energy is, the higher cost everything is. So AOC will say, oh, who cares about the cost of energy? But no, if the cost of energy is low, everything in life is affordable. If the cost of energy is high, everything becomes unaffordable because we can't afford to use machines as much in all of these different ways. So one key aspect of this that's really not understood is the relationship between energy and machines and innovation. People will often say, hey, Alex, you know, why are you saying the Earth is better because of fossil fuels and machines? Isn't it because of better sanitation, medical research, technology? And the answer is yes, but all of those depend on fossil fuels. So why didn't we have much medical research? Why didn't we have much technology? Why didn't we have good sanitation before? Because all of our time was spent just producing our bare necessities and protecting ourselves from the dangerous rest of the planet. Once we had machines to produce food for us so that we could produce our protection against our environments, like produce sturdy homes at low prices, once we could do that, then we had the time to build sanitation systems. And most important, we had the time to innovate. So today, you take something like COVID-19, where we have millions of people who can study it, who can fight it, who can treat it in different ways. That's only possible because we have so much machine labor in our society. So one way to think of it is, without low-cost, reliable energy, you have a manual labor society. And with low-cost, reliable energy, you have a machine labor society and a mental labor society. The machines do so much work that human beings can spend lots of time doing mental labor, which includes innovation. So when you think of all these things, connect them to fossil fuels. And then the final thing that's not appreciated about energy is that energy makes our environment much better. And I want to focus on the issue of climate, because people think, oh yeah, energy, fossil fuels are causing a climate catastrophe. Well, how would you measure that? If you're looking at it from a human flourishing perspective, the number one measure you would want is how many people are dying from climate-related causes. And we actually have really good measures of this, including something that's called climate-related disaster deaths. So from the media, you would think, oh, of course, those are going up. Everything is getting worse. But in fact, they've actually been going way down as we've used more fossil fuels. So climate-related disaster deaths have gone down by a factor of 98% over the last 100 years. And I have brought this up for the last 12 years debating people, and nobody has any answer to it. So it's crazy. We claim to care about climate, and yet we don't know that climate-related disaster deaths are going down. So this is a perfect example of how it's all about philosophy. If you look at climate from the perspective of how livable is it for humans, it's actually better than ever. But people view it as worse than ever because they think it's wrong for us to have any impact on climate, even if it's overall better. So that's really, I believe that's a philosophical or religious dogma. That's not a scientific view. Scientifically, from a human perspective, we're better off than ever from climate because we have all this energy and machines protecting us from climate. Like you think about things like drought relief. Talk about drought today. I live in California, but now we have irrigation. Now we have drought relief vehicles. That has brought down the death from drought by 99%+ over the last 100 years, yet nobody talks about it. But we make the Earth a much better place by using fossil fuels. So the overall idea is that fossil fuels, low-cost, reliable energy, but fossil fuels in particular, they're fundamental to human flourishing. So they make the Earth a livable place. Without fossil fuels, Earth is not a good place even for 1 billion people, let alone 8 billion people. There's one final fact about this that's crucial that's not discussed that I mentioned before, which is that 3 billion people lack reliable, low-cost energy. So you think about that. That is like a total tragedy, and yet nobody talks about it. Again, because people aren't looking at things from a human flourishing perspective. So there are 835 million people without electricity. There are 2.7 billion people who are still using wood and animal dung. We should be focused on this. We should really be focused on the world needs more energy, including more fossil fuels. I think that's a winning message, and it's definitely true. So the summary so far is that continuing fossil fuel use is essential to billions of people having the reliable, low-cost energy they need to flourish. And so restricting it, it really is, that's actually the end of the world. People think, oh, climate change is the end of the world. Actually, depriving the world of fossil fuels in the way that's being discussed, that's actually the end of the world for billions of people. It's like the whole world has what's happened in Venezuela, but worse, where you take a relatively prosperous place, you just totally wreck it, and you bring it to a third world status. Like, that's absolutely what lack of energy does. So the final topic I'm just going to talk about very quickly, and I'm happy to answer questions about this, is climate. But it's actually not as complex as you think, not because climate science isn't complex, but because whatever happens with climate that's at all plausible, human beings can master it. This is what's not acknowledged about climate. Climate is always dangerous, but if human beings have energy and technology and development, we can deal with just about any climate problem. So I just want to quickly go over that. And so this is my overall view, is that continuing fossil fuel use will cause some warming, but it'll be slow and masterable, not catastrophic. So just very quickly, I'm going to share with you three facts that changed my views. So one is that our environmental experts who are talking about this issue, they've been claiming catastrophe, imminent doom for 30 plus years. So for example, here's John Holdren, who is President Obama's leading science advisor. He predicted in the mid-80s that we could have up to a billion related climate-related deaths by now, by 2020, in fact. And that didn't happen at all. And he said it would be from famine, and in fact, the world is better fed than ever. Or this is a UN, prominent UN spokesperson saying, oh, entire nations are going to be wiped off the map if we don't do something about global warming by 2000. And that has not even remotely happened at all. So that's the first fact, is that these catastrophe predictions have a very bad track record. The second thing is that we're safer from climate than we've ever been. So I showed this, but I just want to stress it. This is a really important fact. We're safer from climate than anyone's ever been. The key to safety from climate is having low-cost, reliable energy. It's not having some perfect climate. There is no perfect climate, but there's having a very adaptable species. That's what we want. And so what I call the climate mastery benefits, our ability to master climate, to take the danger and neutralize it, that is the key. And so that has been the dominant thing. So the final fact, and this just goes a little bit into the science, I think it's just important, that while people have predicted that we're going to have runaway warming, the actual amount of warming has been 1 degree Celsius, about 2 degrees Fahrenheit, in the last 170 years. And sea level rises have been very slow. So again, this is just mainstream science, but people are interpreting it not from a human flourishing perspective, but from a human impact is bad perspective. Because from a human flourishing perspective, this doesn't really matter that much, and it is actually in many ways good. So I do believe we impact climate, but here's where we are in history. If you look at CO2 levels and temperature, so CO2 is purple, temperature is blue, we're actually at a very low point in this planet's history in terms of temperature and CO2. Some of the most thriving periods of this planet's history had very high temperatures and very high CO2, and they don't even correlate. So we have no way of getting CO2 where it used to be even if we wanted to, so that's one reason not to be alarmed. This is to give you a sense of how much warming has actually happened. So this is New York City. This is the last 150 or so years. So usually you see these charts that look like this. What they do is they just take a very small, like 1 degree, and then they compress it. So it looks like, oh my gosh, 1 degree is huge. But like on a regular time scale, you can barely detect how much difference it is. So what happens with warming, it's not that it goes from cold to warm or nice to warm or nice to hot. It just goes from a big range of warm and cold to a slightly higher range of warm and cold. So again, there's no reason from a human perspective to consider this at all catastrophic. This is sea level rise. This is from Wikipedia, which is super biased against fossil fuels and against me, by the way, last time I looked at my entry on Wikipedia. And yet even they admit sea level rises are almost non-existent compared to what they were for our ancestors, who were much less adaptable. So I do believe we're making sea level, we're having some impact, but it is very, very slow. It's totally masterable. So the overall idea with climate is we will continue to have a warming impact, but we'll continue to overwhelm it with climate mastery. And so the overall thing is it's not even a close call. The benefits of fossil fuels, really, fossil fuels make the world a livable place for billions of people. If we use more of them, it can be a more livable place for more people. Human flourishing can be an opportunity for more people. And the side effects, particularly with climate, we can totally deal with them. We're modern human beings. We can adapt. We can master things. The idea that there's no way for us to deal with wildfires, we can talk about any of these you want to ask about, that just should strike us as crazy. So there's no climate catastrophe at all. The real catastrophe is lack of energy. Billions of people lack energy. And if we deprive the people who have it of energy, then the rest of us will be experiencing that kind of catastrophe. So I want to just, before I take questions, I want to point you to one website in particular that I created. Actually, I think since I last spoke to YAF, which is called energytalkingpoints.com. And so if you go to this website, you'll see on any issue you can imagine, you get really quick talking points. Every one of them is well referenced. They are, you can tweet any of them. They're all tweet length. So highly encourage you to take advantage of that. So you can not only use kind of the high level perspective, but any issue you can think of pretty much, go to energytalkingpoints.com and it'll help you out. So if you want to contact me for any reason, anyone here online, just feel free to email me directly, alex@alexepstein.com. And I just want to say again, I really do believe that one of the best things you can do in terms of making the world better is fighting for the freedom to use more fossil fuels. So I hope I've been able to at least indicate to you why that might be a possibility, and then I hope you look into it more and become maybe as passionate about this issue as I am. So thanks for having me, and let's do some questions. Oh my God. I'm sorry I didn't leave enough time. I'm gonna go really fast.
All right. How you doing, Mr. Epstein? My name is Jack Parr from Mississippi State University. I'm so sorry about your last name. And I just want to...
It's Epstein.
Epstein, I'm sorry. I must have mislastnamed you. But so my question really goes back to fossil fuels are good, and I really agree with some of your talking points on the environment, but We only have a limited quantity of them. So what do you think we should do? You know, when we get near the end of their life cycle, how should we replace them?
So yeah, so I mentioned there's 10 times more of them in the Earth than we've used in the whole entire history of civilization. So the only thing we need to do is have freedom so that A, we can develop the fossil fuels as intelligently as possible, and B, so that we can explore alternatives, particularly nuclear, which we have tens of thousands of years worth of supply. So we should not be worried about supply at all. A lack of supply, we just need to be worried about a lack of freedom.
All right, thank you.
All right, I'm gonna try to be very quick.
My name is Jacob Fertle. I'm from King's College. And as a philosophy major and a advocate for nuclear energy, I really appreciated this talk, so thank you. My question is, what would you say to those that are against nuclear energy because of the risk that it can happen, of the small risk that a nuclear meltdown happens?
Yeah, so nuclear energy is by far the safest form of energy ever created. It's far safer than fossil fuels and anything else. So if you look at... If you look at the history of it, like in the civilized world, there's been basically no deaths from radiation. So meltdown is basically just, it gets really hot and it melts, which is a hell of a lot better than most forms of energy, which explodes. So the great thing about nuclear is it can't explode. It can just melt down, and that's very rare. So explosion is the problem, because when explosion happens, like a dam explodes or a natural gas thing explodes, then people die. So again, it's the safest form of energy. And I would encourage, I have some stuff on energytalkingpoints.com about that, but that's the number one takeaway. It's the safest form of energy, so people who oppose it as dangerous are either ignorant or they're deliberately manipulating you because they have some motive they don't want to admit.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Matt Landon. I'm from George Mason University. And my question is, what are your thoughts on geothermal heat and energy?
Yeah, so geothermal is, you might hear it, it's most used, I should say, in Iceland. So it's kind of like hydro, but worse. So hydro only works in certain places. Geothermal today only works in certain places. We have a lot of heat very near the surface, so it's very location limited. There's something called deep geothermal that has more long-term potential, but it's like, they're still at the experimental stage. So all of these alternatives, although solar and wind I think are less promising, like what we want is we want freedom for all the alternatives, but we do not want to mandate inferior alternatives today. So we should absolutely be free to explore geothermal, but we should not mandate it. And one other thing to say about geothermal is the green movement will absolutely oppose geothermal. They oppose anything that has an impact. So the green movement is only in favor of one type of energy, which is imaginary energy. I just want to explain that. That's a literal truth. Because they're against anything with impact, so they pretend to support sources of energy, but then if they become practical, they'll oppose them. So even with solar and wind, you're seeing there's huge green opposition to mining for the stuff, to building it in certain places, to building transmission lines. So a key idea I want to get across, green means anti-impact. It means eliminating human impact. That's an anti-human, anti-energy movement. So if they claim to support geothermal, that's a fraud. They don't really support it. They're just using it as an excuse to oppose what works right now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Emmanuel from Furman. What do you think about solar panels being used in calculators to replace batteries?
By the way, Furman is, I went to Duke, which I think is the nicest campus I've ever seen. Furman might be the nicest next to Duke, so that was an amazing campus. So the question is always what's cost effective. So if you live like really, like if you're giving calculator to somebody who lives in a poor place with no electricity, you should definitely give them one with a little solar panel in it. But usually putting solar panels in things where we have a grid doesn't make any sense and it's just being done for show. But it's all about what's actually cost effective versus, but I should say, so solar is generally good when you're off grid and when you need very little energy to do something and when you don't have many options. So solar is great, like if you have a house that's 30 miles away from anything and you don't want to run very many appliances, that's great. But it can't power steel mills. At least it's nowhere near doing it today. Yes.
Hi, my name is Justin Weiss. I am from the University of Southern California. And nuclear energy, as you've admitted, is definitely the best form of energy we have. So when and how should we start combating the green movement in order to get a head start on nuclear energy so it's able to integrate and then eventually overtake the
fossil movement? Well, yeah, so I should say I think it has a potential to be the best. It's not the best right now, because to me the best means low cost, on demand, versatile, every form of machine, and then for billions of people in thousands of places. Right now only fossil fuels can do that. Yeah, the problem is the green movement has been combating, it's not about getting ahead of it, it's like stop being behind. So I think the number one thing is just for, and I think Republicans are gonna have to do this. I don't really care what party does it, but I don't think there's a chance right now. Democrats will do it. Like Republicans should definitely, and I work with a lot of officials and I'm encouraging this, they should definitely have in their next platform a nuclear decriminalization plank. So I'm actually working on developing that policy, but I think it's always important to have a positive policy. So it's not just about, oh, the anti-nuclear people are bad, but here's what we need to do. And so there are massive specific reforms that are needed, but I think overall we need to have the idea that, hey, nuclear has amazing potential, we need to liberate it, and we need to stop demonizing it. Did we run out of questions? It still says I have 5 minutes, but maybe that's wrong. Is that it? Oh.
Are we done?
Oh, go ahead.
I have a question. What are your thoughts about corn ethanol, and then also about like trash to oil?
Trash
to oil. Yeah.
Okay. So my general view is energy freedom, that everyone should be free to compete. So corn ethanol is overwhelmingly, that's only something that exists because of government in the quantities that it does. You know, it's particularly to appeal to people in Iowa. And so that needs to be totally gotten rid of as a thing. So there's more complication to that, but basically, yeah, that's overwhelmingly the product of like there's something specific called an ethanol mandate. That's the reason that exists. And then trash to oil, these things are generally good, but they're good if you can do them cost effectively. The thing to always recognize with these though is you're not gonna replace a lot of supply with something like trash. Or take French fry oil. People say, like, why can't you use French fry oil for a truck? And it's true you can, but there's not that much French fry oil in the world. So it's fine to do these things, but it's not fine to act like they're a scalable replacement. So when we're thinking about energy, always think about, is there a scalable replacement? This one guy came to me once and he's like, hey, I can replace, I can sell fuel cheaper than oil and I don't need subsidies. And I said, great, how are you doing? And he said, oh, I'm using waste alcohol from beer. I said, okay, that's great, but I hope we don't drink enough beer where we can power everything just based on the waste alcohol from beer. So these things are okay, but they're not at all scalable replacements.
Thank you.
Yes.
How's it going, Alex?
Hi.
I'm from Bucknell University, and I was just wondering, you said in your talk that fossil fuels could be used to kind of avoid some of the climate problems that we could be experiencing with, like, increased living quality and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But as we know, fossil fuels are a limited resource, and you're a philosopher, so I was just wondering, do we have a duty to future generations to transition to more renewable energy and not just keep consuming these fossil fuels, which will eventually run out?
Yeah, interesting question. And I definitely don't have any obligation. The number one thing we need, so imagine people had said 100 years ago, when they didn't know about nearly as much fossil fuel supply as we know about today, imagine they said, okay, we're going to help out Alex and, I forget, what's your name?
I'm Peter.
Peter. Alex and Peter, we're going to help them out, so we're going to not use fossil fuels. How would that have worked out for us? They would have just made their lives terrible, and there would have been no progress, and then we would just be poor. So the key thing is, every generation in a capitalist society is always helping out the next automatically because they're discovering knowledge about how to be more productive and prosperous. So the number one thing, even more than all the physical resources that we inherit, all the development, is the knowledge. So as we keep using fossil fuels, we develop the knowledge of how to use other things. So yeah, no, we should not worry, and there's so much of it in the ground, we shouldn't worry about that at all. We should be worried about lack of freedom. And we see with nuclear, like the problem is we're not allowed to pursue nuclear. But no, there should be no restrictions whatsoever, and I don't think it would, I know for a fact it would just hurt people. So that's just a very kind of ascetic perspective, and maybe the philosopher perspective is the world has unlimited resources, because resources are not something that nature gives us, they're something that we create. Again, aluminum is not naturally a resource, oil is not naturally a resource, uranium is not naturally a resource. The world is just raw matter and energy, and our minds make it into a resource. So we need to never worry about running out of resources, worry about running out of the freedom to create resources.
Thank you.
Hi, sir. My name is Jake. I'm from South Korea. And my question is short. I believe that there are still a lot of people who are shouting for eco-friendly, sustainable, by ignoring this fact and the data. As a philosopher, what do you think they are behaving like that? And what do you think their mental state is?
Say the last part of it again. What do I think their what is?
What do you think they are behaving like that? And what do you think their mental state is?
Oh, the mental state. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's a good question. So I think the thing is, I think the main thing I mentioned is these two things. So there's this goal of eliminating human impact on Earth. That's a moral goal that we've been taught is good as a society. And there's this idea that the planet is a delicate nurturer. So they go together. So it's this basic idea that morally we shouldn't impact the planet. And then if we do, the planet is going to get angry and punish us. And I just want to say this is a primitive religious view. There's no foundation to this at all. And my view is, no, we should advance human flourishing, and we do that by intelligently impacting the planet. But I'd say most people have bought into this false moral idea and this false delicate nurture dogma. And part of the reason that's put over is because people associate not impacting the planet as leading to a good environment. And so I think it's really important that advocates of freedom make clear that's not at all true. We make the planet into a good livable environment by impacting it intelligently. So we take naturally dirty water, we make it unnaturally clean. We take a naturally dangerous climate, we make it unnaturally safe. Even with enjoying natural beauty, we can only enjoy natural beauty if we're productive enough so that we have the time and the resources to actually go to the Grand Canyon. Poor people do not go to the Grand Canyon to get inspired because they have the drudgery of manual labor every day. So I think it's really important for people who are pro-freedom for us to be the people who are in favor of a livable world, a livable planet, and to say that freedom and energy in general, and fossil fuels in particular, like that makes the world an amazing place. If you really recognize how great the world is today and how much better it could be because of fossil fuels and because of low-cost, reliable energy, it's very hard to argue with. You know why? Because nobody can contradict that at all. It's a fact that life is better than ever. It's a fact that fossil fuels are underneath that. And if you can make that point to people, you have so much more credibility about the future. One final point is the people who claim that the world is going to get worse in the future, almost all of them deny how good the world is today. So why would you ever trust somebody to make a prediction about the future who doesn't even know what's happening in the present? And when I point this out and when I point out, hey, all the people saying solar and wind are going to replace fossil fuels, they don't point out that solar and wind are failing around the world and haven't come remotely close. All the people who are claiming climate catastrophe, they don't acknowledge that we're safer from climate than ever. So if you know how good the world is, you know why it's good, then the other side has no argument because their argument is really distorting the present to make up nightmares about the future. But if you recognize the present and why it is, then you can understand that freedom and fossil fuels are going to make the world a lot better, and it's actually the people who want to restrict them who will make life worse because they're going to make it more natural. All right, I'm out of time. Thanks so much for having me. Oh, thank you. All right, thank you.